Welcome back. Continuing Velvet Underground. Here we go. Next track. Run, run, run. Thank you for joining me. Gosh darn it. I was hoping to it would go seamlessly together, and it ruined it for me. All right, here we go. This is a reaction channel, in case you're unaware.
Teenage Mary said to Uncle Dave, I saw my soul, must be saved. Gonna take a walk down Union Square. You never know who you're gonna find there. You gotta run, 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 run. Take the dragon too. Run, 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 run. Jim's the death of you. Tell you what to do. Margarita Passion, they had to get her fixed. She wasn't well, she was getting sick. Went to sell her soul, she wasn't high. Didn't know, think she could buy it. She would run, 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 run. Take the dragon too. Run, 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 run. Gypsy death in you. Tell you what to do.
This is a very fun rock and roll rhythm to it. That was an amazing solo.
C6 Sarah had a golden nose, hobnail boots wrapped around her toes. When she turned blue, all the angels screamed. They didn't know, they couldn't make her sing. She had a run, 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 run. Take a dagger too. Run, 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 run. Jim's the death in you. Tell you what to do. Beardless Harry, what a waste. Couldn't even get, say, small town taste. Rode the trolleys down to 47. Biggie Beef was good. You get himself to heaven, cause that a
run, 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 run. Take a dagger too. Run, 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 run. Jibs to death in you. Tell you what to do.
Wow. Okay. That was something. That was fun. I liked it. Cool, cool, cool. That's Run, Run, Run by the Velvet Underground. Thank you very much for joining me. If you're new to the channel, my name is Daniel. Here we react to music. That's all that's important. Run, Run, Run follows a number of characters. Teenage Mary, Margarita Passion, Seasick Sarah, and Beardless Harry, all of whom are seeking drugs or engaging in acts of drug use. Written on the back of an envelope by frontman Lou Reed while he and the band were on their way to a gig at the Cafe Bazaar. The Cafe Bazaar. I want to play there. That sounds cool. Teenage Mary said to Uncle Dave, I sold my soul. Must be saved. Gonna take a walk down to the Union Square. You never know what you're gonna find there. Run, 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 run. Take a drag or two. Run, 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 run. Gypsy Death and you. Tell you what you do. Lou Reed doesn't just write about squalid characters. He allows them to leer and breathe in their own voices. And he colors familiar landscapes through their own eyes. And in the process, he's created a body of music that comes as close to disclosing the parameters of human loss and recovery as we're likely to find. That qualifies him, in my opinion, as one of the few real heroes rock and roll has raised, says someone from Rolling Stone. So, you know. Mary turns to an adult she can trust who won't judge her for that, either in order to get help in overcoming drug addiction or in order to get money so she can do more drugs. Your soul means your essence, your goodness. It's a spiritual term where your soul is who you are, your core. Supposedly, you need a soul to move on to the afterlife, so if you sell your soul, you can no longer move on and will be stuck forever in the in-between or in hell. Any person who sells their soul doesn't care about the afterlife. They focus on the materialistic world they live in as human beings. Usually, who sells their soul to the devil exchanges it for money, power, respect, success, etc. And in the context of being a drug addict, selling one's soul might mean falling for drugs, giving your future up for a short euphoric moment in the present. Mary is asking for help so she can get her soul back. Alternatively, Mary could be asking her uncle for help in order to get money for drugs. Locked in Manhattan, New York, located where Broadway and the former Bowery Road, now 4th Avenue, came together in early 19th century. Today is bounded by 14th Street on the south. Although it used to be a stomping ground of burners, hipsters, dopers, dippers, stoners, and boners, all types that your mother warned you about, today it functions as NYU's quad with a lovely weekend farmer's market. And a comment beneath that says, Union Square is not NYU's quad, Washington Square Park is. You never know who you're going to... Did I say what? It's who. In this verse, Teenage Mary's trying to quit drugs. However, in the life of an addict, it's quite hard to quit, and this line illustrates this. She goes to Union Square in hopes of finding someone who can hook her back up on it. Drag here means to inhale from a cigarette or a joint. Gypsy Death is a term from the 60s meaning to overdose on a drug, usually heroin. The song is a tale involving four addicts, with this line inserted to remind both the characters and us of this possibility. Her addiction dictates her life. In a sense, it tells her what to do, whether other commitments, responsibilities, and obligations, whatever other commitments, responsibilities, and obligations she may have come second to getting high, e.g. spending money on drugs rather than paying rent. Margarita Passion had to get her fixed. She wasn't well. She was getting sick. Went to sell her soul. She wasn't high. Didn't know. Think she could buy it. When a drug addict stops their drug for a long period of time, longer period than they're used to, they get withdrawals, similar to symptoms of the flu. Some drugs produce significant physical withdrawal, such as alcohol. Alcohol does that. Wow. Opiates and tranquilizers. Some drugs produce little physical withdrawal, but more emotional withdrawal. Cocaine, marijuana, ecstasy, marijuana. Every person's physical withdrawal pattern is also different. You may experience little physical withdrawal, but that doesn't mean you're not addicted. Instead, you experience more emotional withdrawal. Okay, and Lou's obviously singing a, let me go, there's a whole lot of information here, but I'm going to read it anyway. Lou is obviously singing about heroin in this song, so that established, I'd like to clear up a few things about this previous post's quote. Withdrawal from heroin is both physical and mental, and though, as any seasoned opiate user who has kicked a couple of times will tell you, the mental aspect is far more torturous and difficult to overcome, the physical withdrawal is very real, always there, and very little in common with the flu. Think more along the lines of the flu, plus panic attacks and insomnia, with the constant reminder in the back or front of your brain that 20 bucks can fix everything, and you're getting close. I would beg for heroin withdrawal to be like the flu. At least there are things you can easily and legally do to find comfort from that. But heroin withdrawal is a much different monster. It is cold chills followed by sporadic hot flashes, hot and cold sweats, then chills with sweaty skin, eyes watering, nose running, yawning, sneezing spells which turn into dry heaving, vomiting bile, stomach and bowel cramps as all the constipated, rock-hard stool you have backed up attempts to work its way through your guts like concrete, So after it's about the fourth time you crap that day, it starts turning into diarrhea, nausea, loss of appetite, high blood pressure, nosebleed, severe body aches, accompanied by zero energy. You feel like you've been run over by a bus. Severe restlessness, restless leg syndrome, but also in your arms and various other body parts. Insomnia, accompanied with all the aforementioned symptoms, but cranked up. So when you try to sleep, you are tossing and turning every 5 seconds in sweat-soaked sheets, unable to decide if you are hot or cold, unable to lie on one side or the other due to body aches, and the mental is even worse. If you can make it past the constant anxiety, panic attacks, and hopeless, sinking, heartbroken feelings of the first couple of days, then you have to deal with the crushing doubt and depression that comes as you realize that even if you make it through the worst of this in about a week, you still have weeks or even months to go before you actually get good natural sleep and start to feel like yourself again. And that, even if you make it that far, there is no prize awaiting you on the other side. All your bridges are still burned. No one trusts you. You've destroyed relationships with those you were close to. You have no job, no prospects. You're likely to have legal trouble. Your living situation is still going to be fucked, whether you're homeless or even worse, living with other junkies, and you realize you basically have no reason to live. So when Lou describes that a junkie is running, they aren't running to get high. They are running away. It's not like a bad flu. If only it were that easy, and if only people showed the same compassion and willingness to help as they would for the flu, then maybe, just maybe, we wouldn't have an opioid epidemic in the country right now. That was 4 years ago, and it's still an issue. Although the names have changed, it's still, yeah. Multiple people that I know have, yeah. Yeah, all right. This line shows the desperation of a heroin addict. She's willing to do just about anything to get a next fix, to stop being dope sick, whether it's stealing, prostitution, etc. Her morality is compromised by her addiction, and therefore she's willing to sell her soul just to be high. Seasick Sarah had a golden nose, hobnail boots wrapped around her toes. When she turned blue, all the angels screamed. They didn't know they couldn't make the scene. Oh. This could be to show the large amount of drug use in the city through the use of multiple characters. Seasick Sarah is referring to a woman being dope sick, which can feel like seasickness. Golden nose is slang for cocaine dealing. Interesting. Boots with nails in the soles. Their purpose is to increase the shoe's durability cheaply. Seasick Sarah was probably wearing them because they were inexpensive, durable, and fashionable to leather-clad 60s junkies. Seasick Sarah finally overdosed, and no one could have stopped her. Not even the angels. She had to run. Then Beardless Harry, what a waste, couldn't even get a small-town taste. Rode the trolleys down to 47th, figured he was good to get himself to heaven. Beardless Harry is a transsexual, not an uncommon theme in Lou Reed's songs. He was not born a man, and that is why he cannot grow a beard. Someone comments that that's not what he's singing about here. From my own perspective, Beardless Harry is just a really young boy who aren't growing beards at young ages. I started growing facial hair when I was like 11. It was very, yeah. Obviously not a full beard, though. All right. That had gotten into drugs and died. That's why he states on the subsequent line, what a waste. He was so young, he wasted his life and couldn't even grow, before he could even grow a beard. Yeah. All right. Couldn't even get a small town taste. Is nothing less than just a low amount of grams, perhaps just one hit. He couldn't even find that to relieve himself. Until they began to be replaced in the 30s and 40s, trolleys were a means of public transportation in New York City. Beardless Harry rode the trolley to 47th Street in Manhattan. Perhaps he committed suicide. All we know is he was without any luck seeking drugs to use. The thesis wouldn't be strange considering his death is a key theme of this track. I think it was more that Beardless Harry was hoping to get high and not hoping or wanting to die. Yeah. Well, there's multiple ways to look at it. And then another repeat of the chorus. That solo. Yep. The solo. The solo kind of made the song. I mean, obviously the song lyrically is very powerful. Very interesting, you know. again, I'm never going to get over that this band is writing these songs at this time period. It's amazing to me. And I have a lot of respect for them for being willing to tackle these this subject matter, you know? I feel like we've come a long way in allowing people to express themselves, which is cool. I don't know. You know? Now if people made songs about drugs or about sex or about S&M, you know, no one would care. No one does care, because people do all the time, you know? And it's a little edgy, but it's not like, it wouldn't have been censored, you know? It wouldn't have had it. Yeah, it's just interesting. And I think it's a good thing that people allow and are more open to hearing about everything there is to hear about. You know, the house that Jack built's a real movie, you know? A Serbian film is a real movie that was made just because it could be, pretty much. Terrible movie, but still. We're at an interesting time for art. And anyway, I feel like stuff like this is what has allowed for this time. So, anyway, all right. Stay tuned for more videos. Thank you for joining me. If you're new to the channel, consider subscribing. And before I go, I just want to plug my own original music. I make kind of experimental rock music, if you want to check that out. It also has, like, folk elements as well. And I actually draw from a lot of different genres, so you might like one or two tracks, or you might like the whole thing. Who knows? I have two full albums out. One is called Mania Machinations, and one is called Paper Skies. I would greatly, greatly appreciate it if you check them out. It would mean the world to me. They're both like an hour long, though, so maybe just like the first one or two songs and see if you like it. But I'm super proud of it, and I want to get it out there to more people. All right, thanks for watching. I'll see you soon. Also, you can find it under the name Daniel Profeta on YouTube and on Bandcamp. Goodbye.